Good evening and welcome to the Hammer and the Nail. Yosef Nasser joined by my co-host, Nahum N.B. Brahani in the South. N.B. coming off of a massive win against Rogo, effectively clinching the playoffs while Knicks' playoff hopes end for good. First off, congratulations, N.B., on making the playoffs.
Thanks. I appreciate that, Yos.
Well, Rogo's expected to address the media in a matter of moments. What went wrong with this season and what's his future with the Hammer and the Nail? Let's go live to Indianapolis. Nick making his way to the podium right now.
As long as it's great. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah, 1 second. You're good.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Nick Rogowski just lost his regular season matchup against NB. He's going to take a few questions from the media. If you've got a question, raise your hand and Nick will come find you. Nick, if you'd like to give an opening statement first.
No, I think it's pretty straightforward. First question.
Hey, Nick, this is Joseph Nascar from the Capital J Sun-Times. It was a season of highs and lows for you. You think about how you started the season, four-game losing streak early on, and then obviously soaring to the heights of leading the league in points. You obviously started a show for the Fantasy League, and then obviously the disappointing result last week against MB, losing to Quinn, losing to Seve twice. When you think about the highs and lows, how do you kind of put the season in perspective? Is this year a failure because you didn't make the playoffs, or are there positives to take away from this season into next year?
Yeah, thanks for the question there, Joseph. No, I think there's definitely positives to take away from this year. Probably my first year ever leading the league in points. Obviously that's not everything in the league. Obviously sometimes it's not enough to get into the postseason, which is the ultimate goal, give your franchise a chance to win. But leading the league in points definitely shows that you were adequate and a decent manager in the year, but obviously with the way the divisions are, played in a tough division, really anybody in this division except for Kyle could have won the championship. But obviously the ultimate goal, like I said, is to win the championship, and you can't do that unless you make the playoffs.
Let's go to second row, third from the right. Hey, Nick, this is Stan Scrounge from the Woodbridge Yearbook Club. I'm Dan's brother. What was it like having Patrick Mahomes and Travis Kelce on the same team? That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah, no, hey, Stan. I know Dan. We went to school together. Great guy. Glad you're living up the legacy there in the Yearbook Club. But no, obviously we relied heavily on Travis Kelce and Patty Mahomes there, the two captains of our team. And, they got us a lot of points throughout the year. They cooled off here when times got tough and we really needed them. But... No, I mean, you can be disappointed in the last 2 weeks or so, but think about all the times that they really kept us in the game and kept games close and won games for us. So that's why we drafted them. That's what we wanted them to do. That's why we paid them the big bucks. And ultimately, it's a disappointment for everybody. I think if you ask them, they would be disappointed as well.
I mean, I feel like we executed at a high level, except for the 1-3 and out drive. But it wasn't high enough because we didn't win.
You know, what are you going to do?
Back corner, second from the left. Greetings, Nick. MacArthur McAllister here from the Plainfield Picayune. You became the face of the league, one of the stars of the league with your participation on the Hammer and the Nail.
More sway.
Terrific show, I might add. Congratulations on your performance there. But I'm wondering, did the spotlight from the show bring any added pressure to you and your team?
I don't know about pressure. I think it's a great question, by the way. Shout out to Plainfield. It's Plain and there's a field out there, but in terms of pressure, I think I feel with my participation in the league since I came in, I think I've made my presence known, and that puts a certain amount of pressure on you. You know, when you're in there day in and day out, chirping the league. Co-hosting the Hammer and the Nail, I think it only kept me more engaged, and I think it only motivated me more week in and week out to play well, and ultimately to get wins and to grow the league and to entertain the league. And no, in terms of pressure, I don't think I felt any added pressure, but I think if anybody in the room puts any sort of pressure on the team, I think it's me. I put the most pressure on the team, and obviously I'm disappointed, but you know, we went out there and we led the league in points. We did all we could do, and sometimes it's just not good enough. Sometimes it's just it's not in the cards for me.
It's never going to happen for me. It's not in the cards for me.
Will you be returning to the show, or are you ending your broadcasting career?
I'm coming back, baby. I'm coming back. Coming back to the show, coming back to the league. All the greats have had to retire at some point in their careers, and quite frankly, maybe I should, but I'm not going to. And next year, I'm gonna make a final.
Middle row, second from the left. Hey, Nick, Andrew Duchard here from the Kansas City Medical Journal. Over the past 15 years, there's been an increased focus on the impact that concussions have had on youth football. And now that you're a father, I'm wondering if your daughter asked if she could play fantasy football, understanding the heartbreak and trauma that comes with the game, would you let her play?
It's a great question. And thanks, Andy, for the question. Ironically, my daughter's name's Andy. I'm sure everyone in the room knows that. But no, I think, you know, without rainy days, the sun doesn't shine as bright. So, you know, heartache gets us through. You have to experience the heartache to, you know, if and when you do win a championship, it makes it that much more special. So, you know, if she wanted to play fantasy football, I would definitely let her. And if she didn't want to play fantasy football, you know, that's her decision. So.
Got time for one more question. Let's go to Yosef Nasser over there in the middle. Hey, Nick, Yosef Nasser, Hammer and the Nail Insider. A lot of people are going to use this loss as an opportunity to take shots at you, your ability to win, your character, your drafting ability, your ability to perform in the clutch. And it's a part of the gig. It's a part of the job. Receiving that criticism, how do you plan on handling some of the criticism that you'll inevitably receive from other guys in the league saying that, you know what, Nick just wasn't good enough this year? What's your response going to be to the critics?
You know, typically I would tell the critics to, ultimately fuck off, but you know, the facts speak for themselves. You know, we're in this league to make the playoffs, and ultimately, like I stated before, I'm not unhappy with the way I drafted. I'm not unhappy with the way that my team performed on the field and statistically, but you know, in the long and the short of it is that we fell short. So I'm disappointed, but, you know, I deserve any criticism that I'm going to get. And I've dealt out a lot of criticism on the show and throughout the league chat this year. So, yeah, I'm going to remain professional. I'm going to, you know, if you can't take it, don't dish it out. So I dish it out plenty. Anything anybody has to say to me, I'm going to take it. Didn't make the playoffs, so, you know, for what it is, you know, I deserve it. But in the long term, you know, fuck the critics.
That's all the questions we have for today. Thanks, Nick. Congratulations on a great season.
Thanks.
Raw emotion from Nick there, MB, but happy to hear that he still will host the show. As for you, a monumental win, as I mentioned earlier, effectively clinching the playoffs. You have the head-to-head tiebreaker against Quinn and the points tiebreaker over both Quinn and Sevy. The only way you can possibly miss out is if you lose, Sevy loses, and if Quinn wins while also outscoring you by 255 points in week 14, a tall task. I don't think he's going to get it. What's your reaction to the win against Rogo and a quick thought on the playoffs, MB?
Yeah, big win against Rogo. I wasn't sure how my team was going to fare, but I think Devontae Smith started it with a touchdown on the first and second drive, and after that, just got exactly what I needed from my team. Everybody came up big, got a waiver wire pickup with the Browns, and they had 17 touchdowns on defense, so shout out to them. But no, shout out to Nick, man. Top point scorer in the league. I know he's feeling it. I know he's, you know, he's going through it. Understandably so. He's put up a crazy effort this season, but, you know, that's fantasy. Sometimes the ball doesn't bounce your way. So, sucks for him, but happy to be in the thick of things. And I think my playoff spot is pretty secure. So I'm happy about that.
Super impressed with Nick. Super impressed with UMB. You guys have been some of the stories of the league. You guys were drafted second and third in the division realignment draft.
MB, welcome to the South.
We're going
to
take Nick Rogowski. We're pretty sure that he's going to be just as bad as MB.
And you guys really came out, made a statement, along with Drisco having a good season as well. Doesn't look like he's going to make the playoffs up north. Also up north, Frank Buckley got a win over the playoff ruiner, Tony Cordova, to clinch the playoffs.
Yeah, Yos. And now Frank has a chance to ruin Sebby's playoffs hopes this week, which I know he's gunning to do. But that has to happen if I get the win over Blocks and Quinn defeats Rogo.
The factory issued this statement earlier in the week.
Quick press conference here from the factory. Listen, first of all, happy Tuesday. Happy Tuesday to all those people that are in the playoffs already. The factory is thrilled to be in the playoffs again this year and to clinch it early enough in the season to where we're not having to sweat it going into the last week. And honestly, I got to take a moment here just to thank a few of the people that made it possible. And I'd like to start with, honestly, the one that's the most important, and that's Tony Cordova. You know, two out of my seven wins this year have been against him. And honestly, like, clinching the playoffs this early wouldn't have been possible without his just poor performance all year. So, Tony, thank you for making that possible. Thank you for helping me clinch the playoffs. And thank you for helping other people clinch the playoffs. You have kept people in the game. And have helped others in the league clinch the playoffs. And, like, what a selfless sacrifice by you. I mean, I understand it's unintentional, and I know you're jealous watching all of us go to the playoffs, but really appreciate your lack of effort and your poor performance this year. And hopefully one of us will take advantage of how bad you are at fantasy football. As you can see, I'm out here in sunny Florida in December. The playoffs are clinched. Just kind of enjoying the rays. Taking it in, relaxing, getting the mind and body right ahead of the playoffs. Are we playing Sevy this week? Yes. Does that matchup matter to me? No. Does it matter to Sevy? Yes. Are we still going to beat Sevy? Yes. And I'm going to do it from Florida. I'm going to do it hanging down here on the Emerald Coast, catching the rays, maybe fishing a little bit. Just sharing this with you, letting you know life is good in the factory. We're always working hard. But once again, the factory's in the playoffs. Looking forward to a great offseason. Here's to all those teams that made it, and here's to Tony Cordova having probably the worst championship title defense of all time. Have a good one.
So strong words from Frank there, and look who's decided to join us back. It's Nick Rogowski. Good to have you back, partner, fresh from the press conference.
Good to be back. Thanks for having me, fellas. Happy to be here.
Well, that makes one of us.
Well, coming up, we had a chance to catch up with Sevy Cordova last week.
And our conversation with Sevy is going to be coming up right after the break.
I'm Yosef Nasser, and I'm a brother.
I'm Nick Rogowski, and I am a brother.
My name's Drew Bouchard, and I'm a brother.
A brother against drunk drafting.
15% of drafters every year show up drunk. 100% of them leave disappointed.
I myself used to be a drunk drafter, and I was saved.
With one small payment of $19.95 and a running back that I can play in the flex, you can become a brother today and make sure that nobody ever has a draft go to waste. Drunk drafting is an illness, one that I'm determined to cure. Call the number on your screen and become a brother today.
Welcome back to the Hammer of the Nail. Yosef Nasser, Nick Rogowski, pleased to be joined by a man who's the vice president of sales at Fiscal Note, one of the best companies in the world, a guy who's the second all-time leading goal scorer in the history of Mason hockey, and most importantly, a man who's defeated the host of this show not once, not twice, but three times this season. Sevi, thanks for joining us. Why do you hate the Hammer and the Nail?
Happy to be here. I don't hate the Hammer and the Nail. I think it's great for the league. I think it exposes people who don't say anything all year. They get on the show and they all start talking. I love it.
Is that a direct shot at Anthony Blocker?
Nope, Nahom directly.
I think that Nahom says a lot of, yeah, in the group chat.
I bet I could go through the last 100 messages and it would be less than five.
Sevi, we wanted to bring you on after the blockbuster trade you made with Bennett. Where were you when you made the trade in terms of how you were feeling about your team, and how do you feel about your team now?
So I didn't feel great after watching my running backs already go from being generally bad to worse. That was bad. I was also physically at Giant, so I consider that to be a win, picking up Thanksgiving food. So I was able to get it done, you know, under all the pressure in the real world. I was able to work out a trade with Bennett. I think he was driving, so we had a long time to like marinate on our conversation. 6 hours later, you know, we got a deal done, and I was pretty happy with the outcome.
Sev, tough start for you this season, but you managed to put yourself in a position to where you're one of the top three teams in the South, a tough division this year. What was the turnaround point for you? Because you've had some adversity. You lost Mike Williams. You ended up trading him. You lost Breece Hall. That was the big dagger, but you're still standing. What do you think? How were you able to get through that time?
I mean, we just drafted for depth. Like, I don't trade often. Tony trades a ton, right? I think I've traded 2 years in a row, but these are probably the only trades that I've made in a long time, right? I just think we drafted for depth. Like, we did. Like, I don't care what anybody says, when Juju Smith-Schuster and Romeo Doubs, before he was hurt, I mean, he was okay, right? He's serviceable. Yeah, like, those guys were on my bench. Like, Gus Edwards on the bench. Like, we just had people in place. I mean, if you guys look at my bench, it's all running backs. In case one of your guys' stars gets hurt, I own all your handcuffs. So, like, it's we drafted for depth. And, you know, if no one got hurt, and this wasn't such an injury-filled year, I think we'd probably be in trouble, right? It's probably not a draft strategy that you want, but because everyone is hurt, gave us the pieces to, like, eat the first couple of weeks and then, you know, put up, like, I think it was, like, 140, 130, 140, you know, from weeks 5, 6, and 7 or something high, right? I don't know the exact number. It was something high. So I just think, like, drafting for depth this year, mostly because of my lack of knowledge during the draft, but I was able to draft a good team for in the long run that would work out. So, yeah, I mean, that's where I'm at.
I mean, if we think about it objectively, let's say Mike Williams didn't get hurt. Let's say Breece Hall didn't get hurt. Sevi's lineup, and I think, Yos, I think going through the past episodes of Hammer and the Nail, I think I've been a big proponent. If we look back at the power rankings, I've got Sevi. I had Sevi in the top five. At that time, I think that might have been week 4 when Breece Hall was going off and Mike Williams was going off and Sevi was sucking all the talent out of both of them. I mean, I had Sevi in the top five. So objectively, Sevi, I think you drafted right and you drafted well to where you can make a run maybe deep into the playoffs.
Sevi, we talked earlier this season. You expressed some concerns about the impact that the embargo was having on the league. I think that you were frustrated that it had gone beyond a joke and something that was really impacting people's decision making. Can you share some of the sentiments that you expressed at the time? And given the fact that you were able to score a big trade with Bennett, do you still feel the same way that you did?
Yeah, I mean, like, look, like, when you create an embargo, you do it because you're helping one side that thinks that they don't need another side. Like, I'm not sure how, like, Frank, I actually give credit to, like, I think Frank's actually like a pretty good owner. He at least knows what a football is. Like, he can throw a football. Like, he generally has an idea, but like, Quinn is clueless. And so like, when you create an embargo between a mediocre, that's like El Salvador and like Venezuela saying like, we're not going to trade with the United States. Like, who cares? Like, but it's created this like kind of animosity throughout the league where like, think about if there were people like, I don't want to talk about the two people that I could have made a deal with this time.
Who are the two people? I think you need, for the benefit of the league.
But here's the thing, like at the end of the day, like trading is a part of this league and being able to make a deal with a multitude of people is something that's important to the league. It gives people the flexibility. Like Quinn is so bad that he housed all these quarterbacks. Nick, you also did too. You housed quarterbacks. And then Jared Goff was the best quarterback in the league as of week three. That's a quote from you.
I think Jared Goff is a great quarterback.
Look at his stats going into week three.
Okay, but he's not, and he knew that. Regression.
I didn't have 14 quarterbacks in my roster like fucking Quinn.
Okay, but Quinn did. Let's draft best player available. Let's get the best team we can, which he didn't because he uses Cricket Wireless and like couldn't get onto the fucking call. So, but like it's true. So like, let's draft the best players that we can on value, and let's embargo ourselves from trading those players to actually people that needed them. If I didn't pick Tua off waiver wires, I was fucked. I have Russell Wilson. I dropped Russell Wilson last week. Please, if someone wants to sign him, go get him. He is so fucking horrible. But my team was fucked. I would never be in the spot I was without Tua. But he could have traded me and abused me. I would have given him something exponentially better for any of those.
You would have given him. Now they're given him fucking Mike Boone.
One thing that we've learned is when you don't use your money early on for players that you take a real chance at, then you end up saving it and then putting $1,000 down on fucking Darren Waller, who's not even going to be back till week 15. So like, it doesn't work that way. You learn from mistakes and you become better. Drew took over the league when he used it on a tight end. Who's the tight end for
Julius the Broncos? Thomas.
Julius Thomas, he saw a need. He did it. He led himself all the way into the playoffs, had an unbelievable team.
Won the championship.
This was my chance with Mike Boone. I took my chance. It was okay. I needed it. And I still managed to get Tua Tagovailoa for $0. So I think it worked out. Like, I consider that a net positive on the year for the money.
So, Sevi, I'm sure you saw the episode. You've been one of our most loyal viewers. Appreciate that. You saw the episode with Tony. He said that the only reason that the two of you are compared are because you're brothers.
I mean, I think the only reason it's a rivalry is because we're brothers. He's always been dog shit. He got lucky a couple of years, and here we are.
He expressed the sentiment that you guys aren't even in the same league. He's much better. I understand where he's coming from statistically, but I do think it's a little bit dismissive of what you've done in this league. You're a champion. You have the most points ever scored in a game at 222. You have come the closest to repeating. The only reason you didn't repeat is because of that wonky trade that allowed Kyle to get extra draft picks. What did you make of Tony's comments when you heard them? And what's your reaction to the way that you two are performing this year?
I mean, it's a way, good question. Well, only one of us is performing this year. So let's dismiss that part. I don't know. Tony always has like, what's it called? Dwarf syndrome or whatever, where people
miss short
people. Napoleon complex. Like Tony has, I don't know why. Like I could care less what Tony thinks. Honestly, like it's a miracle that I can't believe that Tony has been so effective in this league, but I do actually because he makes this his life. Like until last year, honestly, like I show up, I wouldn't say I'm Quinn-esque, right? Because I have like any brain cells. Between Tony and Quinn, like I kind of dismiss everything that they say when it comes to fantasy. Quinn mostly everything, but Tony just with fantasy I'll dismiss. But it's just kind of like, why? Like those two to me.
Quinn has
like,
an MBA now, man.
Here's your question.
He's a doctor.
Let me ask you guys a question. Since you guys are the host, let me turn it on you. Who does the league hate more? Straw poll, Tony or Quinn? Here's the thing. Tony values players like they're incredible. They're the best player I've ever seen. They're worthless. He just overvalues his players, and he tries to trade everybody, which I'm protecting. He doesn't trade me, so that's awesome. Quinn, on the other hand, we talked about Cricket Wireless earlier. I'm convinced that they're the main sponsor of his team. And, like, you have nothing going on but being a bartender. And you have one day of the year you have to show up. Maybe the timing got messed up. But, like, at the end of the day, why aren't you sitting in front of your computer preparing an hour before anyway? Like, Quinn made a mockery of the league. And, like, honestly, if he didn't have the embargo and he wasn't fisting Frank on a regular basis – Quinn would be out the league. Like, people give Driscoll a hard time because he's quiet and he doesn't care. Quinn is my number one person to kick out the league. Out. Bad at
football. But
he doesn't mix it up. Like, he's just so worthless. He's worthless. Like, worthless. But he's bigger than NBA. I congratulated the other day. Got it. Great. Good for him.
But I mean, Quinn does have three sponsors. It's definitely Cricket Wireless, it's Guinness, and it's Vespa. So a shout out to the most sponsored terrible player in the league, but no, I think I'm right there with you. I think Tony's a fucking idiot, but Jakobi Meyers, he was right about him.
Do you think deep down players that are not as involved in the chatter, like Brian, like Blocker until recently, right? Like Raymond doesn't really see it all, so I'm not gonna count Raymond, but like Nahom, Driscoll, they look at these two people. Who do they actually hate more?
I don't know. That's a good question.
I think it's Tony.
You think it's Tony? Why?
Is it Tony? Why is it Tony?
Yeah, why is it Tony?
So quickly? Why do you say that so quickly?
Because Tony is actually good. So when he's winning, it's annoying. Because not only is he winning, he's going to tell you about it. And he's going to throw out the elite statement. And it's just like, at the end of the day, we all kind of – we've been in the league long enough to understand he just won the race to Bennett that year. He drafted a few good players, won the race to Bennett. Whereas Quinn, for me, I would say Quinn is personally annoying. What Quinn has done this year is more annoying than anything that Tony's done. Because like you said, he made a mockery of the league. It's something that we all invest a lot of time in, and the guy just flat out didn't care. And I actually think it's poetic justice, because what happened this year? Quinn happened to get auto-drafted the best value pick in the entire league in Josh Jacobs. And if he had at least tried rounds 5 through 15 or 5 through 16, he would have a chance to win money. But instead, he completely punted on the draft, drafted 3 quarterbacks, 2 kickers, 2 defenses, 7 receivers, and he's got this hodgepodge of a team, and he's awful. So I don't know if that answers your question, Sevi, but
no,
I think
it does. But you're proving my point, though. Is like, I actually think it's Quinn, and here's why. You go in and you say straw poll. They got to pick one out. No one knows their answers. Do they think Tony's better for the league, although he's annoying? He's engaged, or they just straight up kick Quinn out because he makes no impact on the league but be fucking annoying? Probably Quinn, right? It's probably Quinn. So I mean, to be fair to Quinn, though, he's a top 13 manager. Like, that's awesome. Like, congrats to him. He's made it in the top 13. Like, that's
great. Wait, who's 14?
Shut down.
Who's 14?
Oh, my God. It has to be.
Oh, no.
We'll be right back with picks after this.
I'm Yosef Nasser, and I used to get very nervous before my fantasy drafts.
I was jittery and found it hard to focus.
Do I pick? Who do I pick? Then I tried blockers, and everything changed.
Ramondre Stevenson? In the second?
Blockers is an odorless, sweat-inducing deodorant.
I'll take T. Higgins.
That helps you sweat the stress of draft day away.
First time this year using blockers? First time leading the league in points.
For 3 small payments of $9.95 and a tight end, I can plan on a bye week. We'll send you a month's worth of blockers.
Call in the next 15 minutes and you can get a free shirt and a free can of blockers.
Blockers. If you don't sweat it, you don't get it.
Low stress, more sweat. Blockers.
Buy blockers today.
You guys may be wondering what MB is doing here. Well, MB was our first ever guest, and he never got an opportunity to make the weekly picks. And with the last week of the regular season, he asked if he can come on. I'm 39-24. Nick is 38-25. Only one game separates the two of us. MB, the score you have to beat is 6. That's what Blocker put up when he appeared. Drew is second with 5, Sevy 4, Quinn 3, Tony 2. Nick, you observed that that's the order of best to worst in the league this year. Funny how things work out. So where will MB land on this list? Hammer in the nail shirt and a free cup of coffee could be yours if you get 6 or 7 points. Let's get to the matchups.
I do, but right before we do get there, Yos, I appreciate the intro. I do want to add, I did come on week one, didn't get to do my picks, and I think I'm the one who suggested this. So I do want to throw that tidbit in there. I think you forgot that.
MB, if you end up winning the grand prize, I will personally throw in a stale vanilla wafer into the mix for the prize. So here we go.
Sounds good. Just what I needed. Let's do it.
First matchup, it's your matchup, MB. You against Blocker now. Not totally clinched, but an opportunity to clinch for sure against Blocker. Who's going to win this matchup? I think I'm going to go with the big blocks here.
You know, I see a trend, Yos. I feel like you've been picking against me for weeks now, and I don't know what I did to make that happen. But with that being said, I look at my matchups. You know, McLaurin's come on since Taylor's been at quarterback. He has a bye. I don't really like my matchup with Blocks this week, so I'm going to go Blocks as well.
Yeah, and unfortunately, Nahum, I think if you had taken my offer for Jared Goff earlier this season, especially when Dak got hurt, I think maybe this season might not have come down to last week's matchup between you and I. But, you know, that's besides the point. You still got the W, and respect to you. I'm going to go Nahum here. I still think that Nahum, after last week, after he put up 151 on me, you know, I don't think that Block's team really reflects his 11-2 record, and I think that Nahum's team doesn't really reflect his 8-5 record. I think it could easily be flip-flop there. I think Saquon has the ability to put up 50, so I'm going MB here.
I'm blushing, Nick. I'm blushing.
Next matchup, we mentioned Quinn. And Nick, you have a chance to put him out of his misery. Technically, he has a chance to make the playoffs. Sevy would have to lose and NB would have to win because Quinn has the head-to-head tiebreaker, but I say that you put him out of his misery this week. I'm picking Nick.
Yeah, I think that, in timely fashion, Mixon's going to come back and put up 45 the week that I don't need him to do that. I owe Quinn one. So I'm going to be here to play spoiler. I'm picking myself.
Yeah, there's a part of me that wants Quinn to win just to create some chaos around the league, just because I do feel like I'm safe whether he wins or loses. But I do think, like I said, Nick's team goes with Mahomes and Kelce, and I think they're going to come back this week with a vengeance. I think they might beat the Denver Broncos by 70. And I think that the combination of Mahomes and Kelce will beat whatever Quinn brings to the table this week. So I'm going to go Nick.
Next matchup, it's my matchup against Tony. The playoff ruiner hasn't ruined a single person's playoff since changing his team name from Team Tico. And if he's going to ruin my playoff hopes, he's going to need some help. Can Tony handle his side of the bargain? Can he beat me? I'm predicted to win. I'm going to pick myself here. I've got a few guys on byes, but Tony's team has been on bye all season. I'm going to pick myself.
Well said. Go ahead, Nick.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and take Big Yos here. Tony's the worst team in the league, not only in record, but also in celebrity guest appearance picks. So I'm right where he belongs at the shortest of the totem pole. So what do you got, MB?
Oh, I don't know if I can follow those two. I think Tony knows this himself, but his team is littered with Pittsburgh Steelers. So I think that's kind of where he went wrong. Yos, honestly, there's probably two people at this point in this league that I would pick you over. Tony happens to be one of them, so I'll pick you, Yos.
Who's the second one, just for funsies?
Probably Kyle. Ooh. That's about it.
Next matchup, Brian and Raymond. Drisco needs Brian to win if he wants to have a chance to make the playoffs, but Brian, his lineup looking tough this week. Two of his star players on by, Michael Pittman and Randall Cobb. I say Raymond gets it done. What do you guys say?
Yeah, this is the easy one. Raymond, I mean, his team's not that great, but yeah, Brian's team. There's really not much for me to add. Drisco, the fact that, you know, his hopes are in Brian's hands, it's tough. So I think Brian's going to lose and Drisco's going to be on his way out.
Yeah, I think Ramon could probably put Taylor Heinicke in his lineup, even though he's on bye and probably still win by 40. So, sorry, Driscoll, but, you know, you might have put Ramon in his place in that skit last week in the Hammer and the Nail, but I think Ramon's putting you back in your place this week.
Speaking of Driscoll, if he wants to have any chance of making the playoffs, he has to beat Bennett. Can he beat Bennett, who has the first seed in the North clinch? I say he can, but I also say it's not going to matter.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and go Driscoll here, just because I think Bennett's big luck can't hold up for that much longer, especially playing two of the same running backs on the same team, even though they've done well for him. I think Joe Burrow puts the hurt on Jalen Hurts, so I'm going Driscoll, even though, like you said, it's not going to matter.
Yeah, this was the toughest one to pick for me. I think Driscoll has a more balanced team this week. But the combination of Hurts and Diggs scare me a little bit. I'm going to go Bennett.
Our next matchup, it's our game of the week.
Does it matter to Sevy? Yes. Are we still going to beat Sevy? Yes. And I'm going to do it from Florida.
Frank making inflammatory statements in his press conference. Facing Sevy has a chance to take him out of the playoffs, although he's going to need a little bit of help there. Sevy has to lose, and Quinn and MB both have to win for Sevy to be eliminated from the playoffs. Will Frank hold up his end of the bargain? I think I'm going to go Frank here. I don't know if he's going to get the help he needs, but I think that Frank is going to get the win in the matchup.
This is also a tough one. I think I really like Sevy's wide receivers, the combination of CeeDee and Waddle. His running backs need a lot of work. We know the threat of Josh Allen. I mean, he can win a game by himself. So I'm gonna go. I'm gonna go Frank. And also too, I think it's personal between the two. So I'm gonna go. I'm gonna go for Frank as well.
And surprisingly, even though Frank is my daddy, I'm gonna go ahead and say that Jake Meyer is gonna come out of retirement and change positions, and Sevy is gonna pick him up off of waivers and put him into that tight end slot. And I think Gus Edwards is going to put up 45. So I'm going Sevy.
I think Kyle sold the house to Jake Meyer. That's the only thing productive he's done in this league this year. Playing Drew, I think that Drew takes this easily and sends Kyle home fishing. What do you guys say?
Yeah, I don't think this one's close. I think Drew's the monkey in the tree, and I don't think he's falling out anytime soon, so I'm going Drew.
Yeah, this was a super easy one. I think I've been on record for the fact that I don't think Kyle's got enough credit or enough attention for how bad his team has been. So, Yost, this is my call to you and anybody else who wants to, chime in the chat. I think we have to, beat this down. He has been terrible. No chance from the beginning. I think he started with 0-4, maybe won one or two games, and I just think it needs more attention. So with that being said, like I said, I picked Drew, but I think Kyle needs a little more attention in terms of how bad his team has been.
It's winter go home season. MB, thanks so much for joining us.
I appreciate that. Not to cut you off, Yost, but to see you two week one when you guys first started this thing, you guys were, little fellas. And the fact that to see you guys grow and the things that you guys have done over the last course of the season has been impressive. And I'm excited to not only see you guys through the playoff stretch, but to see you guys in the offseason and come next year as well. So shout out to you too. Hammer and the Nail. Nick and Yokes.